Blog Talk Radio.
American Sports History Podcast, live from Cleveland, Ohio, with a brother, a mentor, and a friend, Peter Ray. Yours truly, producing this about 2,500 miles to the west in Los Angeles, Mark Mancini, 347-205-9631. Anything after that, catch it on blogtalkradio.com/Mancini Sports Podcast platforms, wherever you subscribe to podcasts, powered now by Mancini Media. As I lay the red carpet down, put the podium into place, hand off the mic, it's the threes for you, Peter. How are you? How can people get a hold of you? And you're bringing a little Philly Freedom cheesesteaks and the Rocky statue back to this show on a monthly basis. Take it away, my friend, as I man the board.
General Manager is 2017, Lord of the Gridiron, College Football's Greatest Coaches 2019, and the book from 2022 that we are going through, which is really an NFL history book, Lords of the Gridiron 2, Pro Football's Greatest Coaches 2022. Welcome to the show, Mr. Matthew DiBiase.
Hey, it's great, Peter. It's great to be back. Thank you so much. It's always an honor and a privilege to be on your show, and I'm looking forward to a great one tonight.
So we're moving along. The next coach, you got the top in your book, you have the top 50. The next coach we're going to talk about is Mike Tomlin.
Yeah, Mike Tomlin, basically another in a succession of great football coaches with the Pittsburgh Steelers. I mean, first you got Chuck Knoll, then you got Mike Cower, and then, you know, you having to succeed two legends like that, and Mike Tomlin came through and, you know, and just did an absolutely outstanding job, you know, just guiding the team. I mean, what's amazing is that Mike Tomlin has never, ever had a losing season, which is astounding. Yeah. I mean, you know, Chuck Knoll had losing seasons. Bill Cowher had, I believe, some losing seasons, and yet Tomlin never has. I mean, he's the last Pittsburgh Steelers coach to win a Super Bowl, the second African-American coach ever to coach a Super Bowl winner after, you know, Tony Dungy. In fact, he took over a team, managed to rebuild it thanks to Ben Roethlisberger, gave Bruce Arians a real good chance to elevate his career at making him offensive coordinator, and that's one of the reasons why Pittsburgh was able to win the Super Bowl. And he's just been steady. I mean, sometimes he has some lean years where they don't make the playoffs and all that, but always the Steelers are competitive, they're gritty, they're tough, and they just manage to scrape it out. And he started off, yeah, he was born in Virginia, and he played football, and not really a star. I mean, he didn't play he played at William & Mary, And not an exceptional college athlete, but as soon as he graduated, he just got into coaching. He became a wide receiver coach at VMI, and then he moved on to the University of Memphis. And always his specialty was working with defensive backs. I mean, he got basically pigeonholed in that position, first in colleges and then the pros. And he caught some lucky breaks. I mean, one time, in 2001, he just tried out, for a defensive backs coach position with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. It was just basically get his feet wet. He didn't really think he had a shot, but he came to the attention of Tony Dungy. He had Monty Kiffin, there too. And what they did was they had this the specialized school where Dungy and Kiffin would basically test coaches, see who had some real potential. Tomlin went in there not really expecting, that he would do much, but actually he made such a good impression with Dungy and Kiffin, they said, okay, come along with us. And he became a defensive backs coach. So Dungy was really key in giving him his launch in the NFL there. And he gave Mike Tomlin his head, and Dungy and, of course, Kiffin was a great defensive coach. And he learned that Tampa 2 defense. And it's what's interesting is that even after Tony Dungy was fired, the man who succeeded him, John Gruden, kept him on. And in 2002, the Buccaneers made it to the Super Bowl, and they had that fantastic performance against the Oakland Raiders where they beat them 48-21. They had 6 interceptions, which was, I believe, still a team record. And of those 6 interceptions, 3 were pick sixes. And that's all because of Mike Tomlin, he worked with those defensive backs. And he stayed on with Gruden, and then finally he became defensive coordinator with the Minnesota Vikings. That was a step up. No longer was he, a defensive backs. Now he was defensive coordinator with the Vikings and working with Brad Childress. And again, even though the Vikings really, I forget what the hell they did in 2006, but they didn't do that much, but their defense was very solid. And that drew the attention of the Pittsburgh Steelers with Art Rooney's son, Dan Rooney. Rooney was instrumental in creating the Rooney Rule, which encouraged, NFL teams, you got to give a minority coaches a chance there. And this was a chance for Dan Rooney to practice what he preached. Mike Tomlin gave a killer interview, and they realized, we've got our man right here. So when Bill Cowher stepped down, Mike Tomlin just came in and filled the void, and he took it from there. Excuse me, I feel a sneeze coming up. Got him. They lost in the wild card in their very first season, but in his sophomore year, won the AFC North title, and just took it all the way to the Super Bowl. And he just it was a great performance there. I mean, they managed to win, and it was a tough game, but he handled it perfectly. He handled all the pressures, and they managed to pull off a great victory there. And now the thing is, though, they haven't, now they lost in 2010, they lost to the Packers there, and they haven't been back to the Super Bowl ever since, but they've still been competitive. Sometimes they lose in the wild card round, sometimes they lose in the division round. In 2016, they managed to make it to the AFC Championship game, but, Tomlin just manages to hold it all together. I mean, they keep getting running backs to manage to get some defense there. It's not pretty. But it's just consistent.
Yeah. Now I've got some quotes from your the chapter in your book. Mike Tomlin talked about Tony Dungy. Coaching under Tony Dungy was invaluable. He never rode the emotional roller coaster. I fed off his quiet strength. And then Dan Rooney said about Mike Tomlin, Mike really impressed us in the interview. He was a family man, knew his history, and loved the Steelers tradition. I could tell he was a good person, and he handled our questions with poise and confidence. And then you wrote about how when he was hired by the Steelers, he said, although he wanted greater intensity from his players, he also leavened that intensity by stressing humility, selflessness, and being grounded. And Tomlin said, quote, I am committed to winning. I am committed to playing a brand of football I believe in. It's a physical game. You win by attrition. You impose your will on your opponent. That's what I want our game tape to look like. And then, let's see, you wrote, Mike Tomlin, I guess after a period of time, recalibrated his motivational tactics, easing up slightly, showing more humor and giving his veteran players more space and leeway to prepare and motivate themselves. And this is current NFL, you know, I've been impressed by Tomlin with his intent. Yeah, you just look at his face. He's just so focused and concentrated.
Yeah, and, getting back to what you said was that in his first season, he ratcheted up the intensity, but he was just a little too intense, and that's why Pittsburgh went down in the wild card game. Basically, emotionally, they were just burned out a little bit. So that's in his second season, he did recalibrate. He eased up a little bit. You know, in other words, you know, make sure they peak emotionally at the right time, and that's why they were able to take it all the way to the Super Bowl title in season two there. Another thing was he also insisted his players play with character too, because I think it was like a playoff game. I forget which one it was. I forget if it was in 08 or some other season. One of his D-backs made like a cheap shot and then kind of pouted and all that. And basically Tomlin pulled him off the field. In other words, it was a stupid penalty. And he pulled him off the field. In other words, you're not playing like a professional there. When you show me you're ready to act professionally, then I'll put you right back in. And the guy eased up and straightened out, and he needed to go back in. In other words, you have to play with character there. You have to play, you know, have to play steady. And that's from Tony Dungy. In other words, don't blow your cool. Don't do stupid stuff. You know, just, you know, keep your emotions reined in and all that. And don't get out of control. And that's something he learned from Tony Dungy. And that was something he always imparted to his players there. In other words, don't lose control. Play with passion, but never lose control there.
Yeah, you've got, and of course, his era with the Steelers, these memorable players, Ben Roethlisberger, James Harrison, Troy Polamalu, Antonio Holmes, Santonio Holmes, and T.J. Watt and Najee Harris. Yeah, so he's really something. Any more thoughts on Mike Tomlin?
Here's another thing. When he took over in 07, there was some skepticism about him because there was some talk. I think was it Russ Grimm, who was the offensive line coordinator for the Steelers? I think there was talk that he was going to get the nod, but it went to Tomlin instead. And I talk about this in the book. There was like this little tense summit meeting between Tomlin and Ben Roethlisberger, and Roethlisberger basically said, you know, hey, you know, we were expecting Russ and all that. You know, you've got to prove yourself. And the thing is, Tomlin did prove himself. He overcame the skeptics, you know, and the doubters, and, you know, he led them. And he's been leading them ever since. Now, I mean, he's closing in, you know, let's see. It's going to take a while before he breaks Noel's longevity record and all that. But, I mean, it's just an impressive record there. And, you know, even though the Steelers didn't make the playoffs last season, so he kind of stagnated a bit, Tomlin, you know, will always rank in that top 20, according to my calculations.
Yeah, I think this, again, shows, you know, the Rooney, especially Dan Rooney's ability to judge, judging a guy based on the interview, and a judge of character, and then being patient. Yeah, I've heard people talk about, oh, they ought to fire Tomlin over. And I thought, what are you talking about? This guy's, they're every year, you know, they're in the race, and then they really. So now let's move on to number 19 in your rankings, Mike Holmgren.
Yes, Mike Holmgren. The second greatest product from the Bill Walsh coaching tree. I mean, he and George Seifert, whom we talked about 4 weeks ago. Holmgren was basically the best transmitter disciple of Walsh. I mean, in transmitting the West Coast offense. What he did with Green Bay was amazing. I mean, before his arrival, the Packers were absolutely pathetic. I mean, you know, they had that one, I think they had like two playoff appearances between 1972, you know, and 1991 or something to that effect. I mean, it was just, you know, Title Town wasn't even Title Town anymore. I mean, just the Packers were in a horrible, horrible shape. And when Ron Wolf took over as general manager there and he hired Mike Holmgren, just did an amazing job of turning that team around, made the Packers into winners, then playoff contenders, and then finally, you know, in 1996, he made them Super Bowl champions, and then it went back-to-back Super Bowls. I mean, he lost to Denver and all that, but, I mean, he could have gotten Hall of Fame effort out of Brett Favre. I mean, everyone thought he was crazy for, you know, acquiring Brett Favre, but he took a wild cowboy quarterback like Brett and basically put a harness on him, and by harnessing him and disciplining him with the West Coast offense, He made Brett Favre a Hall of Fame quarterback. There's no doubt about it. I mean, without Holmgren, there's no way Favre could have made it all the way. I mean, he was wild and uncontrollable. But it was Holmgren who basically gave him a structure that allowed Brett Favre to show his incredible throwing skills. And that's one of the reasons why, you know, Green Bay Packers became Title Town USA. And another thing is that Holmgren had to confront the legacy of the late Vince Lombardi. I mean, what a legacy to take on. I mean, all the Lombardi successors all faded, you know, because they just couldn't handle it. And Holmgren never fought the legacy. He embraced it, but he created his own personal legacy there. And it was a brilliant legacy. I mean, his own coaching tree is stupendous. I mean, you know, a second generation. You've got Ray Rhodes, who coached the Eagles and later the Packers, Steve Mariucci, John Gruden. I mean, he really elevated John Gruden's coaching career and placed him on the path where he himself became an NFL head coach and a Super Bowl champion in his own right. Dick Jowren, Andy Reid. I mean, he launched Andy Reid, gave Andy Reid a platform to grow. And then when Andy Reid got to the Eagles and then finally the Chiefs, I mean, Reid surpassed not only, you know, Mike Holmgren, but Bill Walsh too. I mean, amazingly, stupendously. Mike Sherman, Marty Mornerig, Jim Zorn, Jim Elmora, Stump Mitchell, Todd Bowles, who's president, coach of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. I mean, just like Bill Walsh, he was a teacher and nurturer of coaches. He's churned them out there, and they went on to, you know, do some stupendous things. With Holmgren, go ahead. You were going to say something?
No, go ahead.
With Holmgren, though, the problem is after they won that Super Bowl, when they beat the New England Patriots in Super Bowl 31, and I talk about this in my book. I interviewed Harry Sidney, who had played both with Bill Walsh and George Seifert, and then later with Holmgren. Which Harry Sidney told me maybe 2 weeks after the Super Bowl victory, they had a team meeting, and basically Holmgren said, there's no relaxing, we got to keep going. And Harry Sidney later said, he didn't really give us time to enjoy it. And he said, that kind of took the steam out of the team a little bit, because they didn't really have time to decompress, in other words, savor the fruits of victory, drink the champagne a little bit, you know, and relax a little bit. And also in that season after the Super Bowl 31, there were some injuries there. And then when they went up against the Denver Broncos in Super Bowl 32, they were taking on not the old Denver Broncos who got stomped on under Dan Reeves. This was Mike Shanahan's Denver Broncos, a team that finally had a defense and a ground game to complement John Elway's magnificent passing skills. And they had that bit in their teeth, and they hung tough. And basically – They managed to get, if I recall correctly, it was a tie game at halftime, but then they just allowed the Denver Broncos just to grind it out thanks to Terrell Davis and all of that. And they were able to contain Brett Favre with their defense, and it was a tragedy that they lost, you know, but the fact that they got him to back-to-backs. And also, another aspect is that after that Super Bowl 31 victory, Holmgren himself kind of changed a little bit in a sense. I know there's a biography of Brett Favre by Jeff Perlman that basically said Holmgren's ego grew, and it kind of cast a shadow in the locker room there, and it kind of changed him a little bit, and maybe not exactly for the better. And Holmgren got restless. He wanted more. He wanted a situation where he had total control, and he was not going to get it with the Packers, not as long as Ron Wolf was there. So in a sense, After 1998, he wanted to leave, and finally he did, and he found that situation with the Seattle Seahawks, because they gave him total control as both GM and head coach, and it was a slow, painful process when he went to Seattle. I mean, he got a winning season there in his first season there, but then for three straight years, the team was kind of floundering. I mean, basically playing, he had a losing season, then a winning season, then another losing season, no playoff appearances. He was retooling. And actually, the irony is when he quit being a GM and just focused solely on head coaching, that's when the team took off again, and he reconstituted. And finally, he got him back into playoff contention. And finally, in 05, he led the Seahawks to their very first Super Bowl appearance. And the irony is they lost to Bill Cowher's Pittsburgh Steelers there. But finally, he got him over that hump. He got him into the Super Bowl. And the thing was, though, he never could recapture that magic. And then finally, by 2008, he had a bad losing season. He finally called it quits and all that. That's why I have him after Mike Tomlin, though, because there were those lean years, especially with Seattle and this failure to make the playoffs there. Because, like I said, Tomlin never had a losing season, whereas Holmgren had at least, three or four losing seasons there. And that's like a negative counterweight there in some respects. And the fact that he lost two Super Bowls, that too is a negative counterweight. Mike Tomlin only lost one. So that cost him some points as well. But Holmgren was a brilliant developer of coaches there. Another thing about Holmgren is, before he went to the pros, he had started off. He actually was a quarterback at USC under John McKay during their glory years there, late 60s, early 70s. The thing was, he was strictly a bench warmer. He never got enough. He never played enough even to get a letter at USC. But he kept going anyway. After he graduated, he tried for the pros but didn't make it. And then he was teaching. He was teaching at a local high school and also coaching football there. And then finally, he was discovered by Lavelle Edwards at Brigham Young University. And that's another thing. Like Bill Walsh, Lavelle Edwards, who's featured in my third book, Lords of the Gridiron, College Football's Greatest Coaches, was another man who he churned out great coaches, one after the other. He would find these great offensive coordinators, like Dewey Warren, Norm Chow, and Mike Holmgren. I mean, Mike Holmgren took over from Doug Scoville, and he helped develop Andy Reid and others. And I think it's Steve Young. He worked with Steve Young there, and I think Robbie Bosco. And if I recall correctly, yeah, he was there when they won the 1984 National Championship. And he grew under Lavelle Edwards because Lavelle Edwards gave him the space to utilize his ideas, try out his tactics on the field, and he had great quarterbacks and great receivers to work with. And Mike Holmgren grew, and he caught the eye of Bill Walsh, who hired him, for the San Francisco 49ers during those glory years in the 80s. And Mike Holmgren filled that void, and he never looked back.
Now, in your book, I got some quotes. You talked about how he got had a an injury as a college player, and he later used this humbling experience to motivate not only his players but also his children as well to never quit or give up in the face of despair and disappointment, to fight it out. And then you talked about Reggie White, one of his players with the Packers. When Reggie White wasn't devouring NFL quarterbacks and running backs whole, he served as a minister of the word in the Green Bay locker room, baptizing his teammates in the Christian faith. And that's great. And then, this quote you got from a Jeff Perlman book, inside the locker room, the players became disenchanted with Holmgren. If you were a star like Brett Favre or Reggie White, he would treat you well. But with winning came an ego. And with an ego came a dismissiveness that rubbed many the wrong way. So now we've got some time for comments here. Let's see. Travis from Orange County. Hey, guys, do you think Mike Tomlin is better than Chuck Knoll, even though Knoll has won more Super Bowls?
No, because Chuck Knoll is in the top 10. I mean, no, way superior to Mike Tomlin. I mean, those four Super Bowls, tell the story there. I mean, tell the guy, go and get my book, and you'll see exactly where Chuck Knoll ranks. He's top 10 material, absolutely, positively, way superior than Mike Tomlin, absolutely.
Sal from Germantown, Pennsylvania. I remember Mike Tomlin with the Vikings. They should have stayed there. That team would have still been the Purple People Eaters.
Yeah. I mean, you know, it could have happened there, but, you know, I don't think that, you know, it didn't happen that way. I mean, the Pittsburgh got in there first. They got in there first, but, you know, that's the way it is.
Steve from Corvallis, Oregon. How about when coaches are in cities too long, they forget how to coach? Players tune them out. Maybe that's what has been happening in Pittsburgh these days.
I don't think so. I think that the Pittsburgh, you know, players get old. I mean, they lost Ben Roethlisberger. They just got to fill the holes. You know, there's always a rebuilding process there. I'm not ready to pull the trigger on Mike Tomlin yet. Well, let's see what time will tell. I think Pittsburgh management is going to give him the chance to rebuild, and we'll see where this goes.
Lance from Pensacola, Florida. Holmgren, the Walrus, Brett Favre, and him were amazing. I liked him at San Francisco as well.
Yeah, I mean, he was the offensive coordinator under George Seifert. And again, when Steve Young took over, it was Holmgren who reassured Steve Young that, hey, you're going to be the starting quarterback someday. Because there were times when Steve Young wondered, will I ever get a shot at being a starting quarterback? And then when Joe Montana got hurt in that 1990, you know, NFC Conference Championship game, that was Steve Young's chance. He filled that void and filled it perfectly and was that, you know, led him to Super Bowl victory.
I like the part you talked about how when Holmgren was hired by the Packers that he honored Lombardi. And
yeah.
I thought that was good because, you know, there tends to be a lack of history. And so anyway, that was really good. And I think that really helped with morale for the whole community.
Here's another thing. You were talking that Perlman quote about dismissiveness. Here's an example of it because I talk about it in my chapter on Andy Reid. When Reid was working as an assistant for Holmgren, it was the Packers there. One time, he suggested to both Randy to Holmgren and John Gruden, "How about using a shotgun formation? For some reason, use a shotgun formation with Brett Favre." And the thing is, in a West Coast offense, the shotgun is a no-no. They never, you know, when you're going to West Coast, you never use the shotgun. And basically they told Andy Reid, when you get to be a head coach, then you can use your shotgun, but we're not going to do that here. And Reid, that kind of nettled Reid a little bit. And when Reid became a head coach and it's all right, he developed a philosophy, which is very beautiful, and it still sustains him today with Kansas City, that he will listen out to any assistant coach's idea and not dismiss it out of hand. In other words, it doesn't matter whose idea it is, as long as the idea works and the team wins, that's the only thing that matters. And that's made him very wide open and very flexible to external thinking. In other words, it's not about my ideas. It's whoever has the best idea, whether it comes from me or from any one of my assistants. The key is, will it get the desired result? Will it win the game? Will it help the team win the Super Bowl? And that was the key lesson that Andy Reid learned from that negative lesson taught by Mike Holmgren there, okay?
Well, okay, Mike Holmgren was the Cleveland Browns president for 2 years. What can you say about that?
Yeah, but the thing was, this was the new Cleveland Browns, and somehow it just wasn't working out, and he finally had to give way. It just wasn't working out because the franchise, in many ways, it's still inconsistent. It can't really find its identity. It's supposed to represent the Browns of the past, but no, they're still like an expansion team that still hasn't found its soul yet.
Our guest has been Matthew DiBiase, the author of four sports books, including the one we talk about every month, every 4 weeks, Lords of the Gridiron 2, Pro Football's Greatest Coaches, which came out in 2022. Matthew, the time has flown by. Do you have any final thoughts for our audience?
Yes, I am a podcaster, although I'm not podcasting tonight. If you next week, I'll be on the air with my show, The Package Tourist, which tapes at 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time every Tuesday night and is usually posted online after 10:30 p.m. I'm not taping tonight, but next week I'll be resuming my show. But you just go online, you want to listen to my Bass podcast, just type in The Package Tourist, Matthew DiBiase, DiBiase, and you'll find the link to my show. So please enjoy.
Well, thanks a million for coming on the show again tonight. Wonderful NFL history.
Yes, I can't wait for the next one.
Yeah, we'll have Matthew back in 4 weeks, June 27th. We'll talk about Bill Parcells, who coached the Giants, Patriots, Jets, and Cowboys, and Bill Cowher, who was a Steelers head coach. Next week, we're going to have Bill North, the center fielder and stolen base champion and two-time World Series champion for the Oakland A's in the 1970s. In 2 weeks, we're going to have Super Joe Charbonneau, the American League Rookie of the Year for the Cleveland Indians in 1980. Dear listener, may the road rise to meet you. May the wind be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face and rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. Good night, everybody. Thanks again so much, Mr. Matthew DiBiase.
Thank you, Peter. God bless you all.
God bless you.
Thank you.
Okay.